These are grocery store Skittles. They taste pretty good, but then if we look at the ingredients, they're filled with sugar and corn syrup and artificial flavors and food coloring. So forget that. These right here are nature Skittles. They still have amazing flavor. I love it. It's so sour, but none of that other crap. Seriously, I am telling you guys, everyone needs to eat this plant at least once in their life. If you haven't, you are in luck, because these plants called wood sorrel or sour grass, or as we just learned, nature's Skittles, are extremely common all across the globe. I'd be willing to bet it's even growing in your yard right now. In this video, I'm going to show you how to identify them and some lookalikes that you should know, because there's at least one that is poisonous but easy to tell apart if you know what to look for. And then great ways to use this plant, some that you might not have heard about before that I didn't even know about before I started experimenting for this video. But if you've been following my channel for some time and you have eaten them before, stick around, because I'm going to be unveiling new information about wood sorrel that I don't think has ever been talked about before. You see, people drastically overemphasize the dangers of consuming wood sorrel in a ridiculous way. I asked all of you if you'd heard about this in a community poll, and more had than not. I've also recruited the help of an expert and registered dietitian to thoroughly debunk all of the myths surrounding wood sorrel danger. I cannot wait to tell you more about this amazing wild edible plant, so let's get started. Wood sorrel are members of the genus Oxalis. Don't confuse the naming with the true sorrels, which are in the genus Rumex, and actually not really closely related to wood sorrel at all. The reason for the similar naming has to do with the etymology of the word sorrel, which comes from the Proto-Indo-European sura for sour. And both kinds of sorrel have very sour tasting leafy greens. This is likely due in part to the content of oxalic acid and possibly other acids in the plants as well. If the content of oxalic acid or oxalates concerns you, don't worry. That is the alleged danger that we are going to be addressing in this video. From the name wood and wood sorrel, you'd think that these plants would mainly be found in the woods, and some of them, like violet wood sorrel, are, but others, like common yellow wood sorrel, grow in open sunny areas like your lawn. I'd be willing to bet that there's some there right now. Identifying wood sorrel is actually very easy, though there are some articles online that can make it really confusing, so I'll try to clear that up. The plant has trifoliate compound leaves. So what you see me holding right now is actually just one leaf with three individual leaflets. Most species have a deep notch at the top, which creates a distinct heart-shaped appearance. I honestly can't think of another shape in nature with a closer appearance to our symbol of a heart. Some species do have greater than three leaflets, like the peculiar Oxalis decaphylla. Decaphylla meaning 10 leaflets. Just look at this thing, it's crazy. But the vast majority of these species have three leaflets per leaf. Wood sorrel flowers are usually yellow to pinkish in hue, but they always have five petals, and many tend to be funneled towards the base. Their seeds come in these long capsule-like fruits. Before we use all these details to compare the plant to lookalikes, I want to show you some of the amazing uses of wood sorrel, but in order to feel good about consuming this plant, I think we really need to address the alleged dangers surrounding them. You may have read articles or heard warnings that you should only ever consume a tiny amount of wood sorrel, due to the content of a chemical called oxalic acid. The way that this is often presented to you, I think, is absolutely hypocritical and ridiculous. There is critical context missing when you are told to only have small amounts, which is that oxalic acid is a very common chemical that is present in many members of the plant kingdom. Oxalates are used for vital plant functions like regulating plant growth and heavy metal detoxification. That's why it's so common. It can be found in plants that you know, like parsley, spinach, chard, rhubarb, and many, many more. And there are people out there that are absolutely pounding their raw green spinach smoothies. Like, you see this a lot in fad diets or cleanse diets and things like that. And you know what? Those people are relatively fine eating all of that spinach. So, if consuming relatively large amounts of spinach is okay, well, then the question becomes, how much oxalic acid is in spinach versus wood sorrel? How do they compare?
Thankfully, in 2024, we get a well-designed study that gives us insight into the oxalic acid content in at least one species of wood sorrel. When we calculate everything out and make conversions from dry weight to fresh weight, we get that wood sorrel has an oxalic acid content of 22.42 milligrams per gram. So, how does that compare to spinach? From this study, we get an average content in spinach of 11.2 milligrams per gram of oxalic acid. So, it's almost exactly half of what is found in wood sorrel. I know that might seem like a lot, wood sorrel having double from spinach, but after seeing this next part, you'll really understand that it isn't. Here is a recipe for a green smoothie that is calling for 2 cups of fresh spinach, which is about 60 grams of spinach. So we would need 30 grams of wood sorrel to get the same amount of oxalates. This is what 30 grams of wood sorrel looks like. You would really need to be going out of your way to gather that much. When I was doing this, I got what I thought was a lot, wasn't nearly enough. So then I got a lot more, still wasn't enough. It was just crazy how many times I had to keep going back out to get 30 grams of wood sorrel. And now think about how people will have these smoothies multiple times per week or spinach in their salad multiple times in a week. Honestly, it is infeasible to think that you could continuously gather and eat enough wood sorrel to get anywhere close to the oxalic acid that you would be consuming with eating spinach. But there are a lot of people out there, especially in the health trend space or the health guru space, and they're going to tell you that consuming any amount of oxalates is dangerous and should be avoided at all cost. So, is that true? Well, I've recruited the help of a friend, Shyla Cadogan. She is a registered dietitian out of Maryland. Not only does she work at a hospital and helps people in critical care situations, but also is an amazing content creator in the space of diet and nutrition. Let's hear her take on oxalates.
Most people get concerned about oxalates, and we have to talk about what oxalates are, and you might have heard oxalic acid being referred to interchangeably, and the reality is they're both kind of the same thing interchangeably, except oxalic acid is the organic acid that is actually in the foods. Spinach, almonds, soy, potatoes. Spinach is the biggest offender that gets all the flack for it. Oxalate is that, but just describes it binded to minerals. So in your body, it can bind to like calcium, iron, magnesium. What most people are concerned about is the calcium oxalate bond. This is what people are scared of when it comes to kidney stones and just health detriments and all of that sort of stuff. But we have to know a few things. One, they can get excreted through the body. And for most people, it just goes right out through the urine, like, and really you don't feel any ill effects from it. For people that might be at risk of kidney stones, it is important to know, and they are the most common reason behind kidney stones. But the thing is, for a lot of people, that's not really helpful to know, because we have to consider that most Americans don't actually eat things like spinach. They don't actually eat many things like almonds. It may not be those foods that's causing that. And so it's been a whole lot of fear created behind it when we have to consider overall generalizable information, and that is that most people aren't eating those things. And the people that are, a lot of them don't suffer from kidney stones or any ill effects from that. And we also have to consider that cooking can break down oxalates. Boiling is the most effective way to reduce oxalate content. Not only that, but eating sufficient calcium can be important. If you eat enough calcium, it allows things to go through much easier. Another way that people can mitigate the formation and the distress that it might have on their body if they're prone to kidney stones is just including magnesium from electrolyte sources. Because what magnesium can do is displace the calcium in the calcium oxalate bond. And the magnesium would make that so much easier, because it made it more water soluble in your body. Think about water soluble as something that's just like less likely to stay in your body for a long time. It just, you go in and you go out. It's an electrolyte, and that's what it does. And it's super, super cool and information that I like to share with people, because it's just not something that is widely understood.
To me, the evidence does not suggest that there is a direct link between oxalate consumption and kidney stone formation.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I'll also mention that your body makes oxalates. It makes it as a waste product. And so we also depend on nutrients to kind of help us get rid of them as well. So for example, if someone isn't eating sufficient amounts of vitamin B6, that can prevent breakdown of oxalates too. The overarching idea is that oxalates are not inherently like bad. You know, there's just different factors that can come into place. And honestly, for an overwhelming amount of people, spinach is not the reason they're getting kidney stones or ill effects from oxalates. So the huge fear, or any plant really for that matter, including wood sorrel, when we look at everything from a zoomed out perspective, it helps us.
Okay, I have to cut the interview there, but we also talked about the relationship between gut health and oxalates, plant anti-nutrients, and more. The full interview is on my Patreon page. Be sure to check out the rest of her work. She is a wealth of information on health. So, now that we've gotten all that out of the way, let's learn about the incredible ways that we can use this plant. First is the simplest. You just have to try it. Find and pick a plant and give it a nibble. That's it. You'll be greeted with a delicious sour flavor for which the plant gets its names, like sourgrass or the one that I like to call it, nature's Skittles. The most common species of wood sorrel that you'll likely come across is common yellow wood sorrel. That is the one that will grow in your yard. But if you're on a hike in a woodland setting, look out for those violet ones. I think they have even better flavor and way more sourness. This was one of the first wild plants that I ever foraged in my life, and I remember the exact moment to this day. I was at a survival class out in Texas, and the instructor showed us the plant. Eating it for the first time, that is just an experience that we all need to have. This is truly one of the best beginner wild edible plants in the world. Please, you have to try it. All parts of wood sorrel are edible, even the root. In fact, one species, Oxalis tuberosa, is cultivated in South America for their large tubers. Gathering wood sorrel is simple. You just pick them. For the yellow ones, which are annuals, I really don't worry about pulling up the whole plant, but with the woodland species, I make sure to only harvest the above ground parts as they are perennial.
I'm out here at one of my violet wood sorrel spots because I really wanted to show you guys the tubers. They look very, very cool, but I think I've just missed them and they've now died back for the season. So I've added violet wood sorrel to my interactive foragers calendar so that next year I definitely won't miss them and I can show that to all of you guys. My foraging calendar helps you time the windows for the flowers, fruits, and vegetables of dozens of different wild edible species. This is the single most important foraging tool that I use, and I think that you'll love it too.
With the tangy flavor and beautiful flowers, wood sorrel makes the perfect garnish for a raw salad or blanched greens, but there are a few other ways that I don't think many people have heard about before. I tried to make a cold infusion with the fresh leaves, just chopping them up and putting them into water, but the taste was pretty lackluster. So then I just took them all and completely blended them, and it was a lot better. It was kind of like a sour cucumber drink, but still only had mild flavor and sourness. So after that, I tried to make a hot infusion, and this was, well, just listen to my live reaction of this. Wow, this is a hot extraction from wood sorrel, and it is delicious. I can't believe that I've never done this before. I haven't seen that you can do this before. Wow, amazing sour flavor. Add a little bit of sugar to sweeten it up. Just like drinking lemonade, really. This is really, really good. Wow, I'm so glad I'm experimenting more for this video. This is delicious. You guys have to try it. I also dehydrated some of the leaves to see if I could preserve the flavor. I think you do lose a little bit, but I was happy to find that it still made a nice sour tea. Add in a little bit of a sweetener and some ice, and you've got a really amazing, refreshing beverage to enjoy on a hot summer day. Many people attribute oxalic acid directly for the sour flavor, but wood sorrel also contains citric acid and ascorbic acid, which you may know as vitamin C, and I think both of those contribute to the flavor as well. Please, please try these drinks out and let me know what you think about them in the pinned comment below. But before you do, you should know about a few lookalikes first. One of the great things about wood sorrel is that they are relatively easy to recognize. But that being said, there are a few other plants that you at least need to know about so that you can distinguish them properly. And like I mentioned before, one of them is toxic. The first is clover, or a trifolium species. If you have confused these two before, it is not your fault at all. Because if you went to Google search clover right now, dozens of the photos that you would be shown are actually going to be wood sorrel. Of course, the flowers between them are completely different, but what about the leaves? That's the main part that we'll be harvesting. Clovers will sometimes have a tiny, tiny notch at the top of the leaflets, but wood sorrels have far more deep and distinct ones, and most of them have that overall heart-shaped appearance, and clover does not. But hold on, isn't shamrock supposed to be clover? And it has heart-shaped leaves too. I know, there is a lot of confusion here. Basically, nobody actually knows what shamrock really is. I think it's supposed to be a species of clover, but at least the way it's commonly represented, I mean, see that right there? That is wood sorrel, no doubt. So, who knows what's really going on here? Is shamrock clover? Is it wood sorrel? I don't know for sure, but clovers have a lot of other uses as well that I'll tell you about in a second. Okay, so for the poison lookalike, it's really peculiar, and you probably have seen it before. It will grow right next to wood sorrel and has these really shiny flowers. I've actually done a whole video on that plant and distinguishing them from wood sorrel, which you can watch right here. And in that video, it will lead you straight to the clover video afterwards. So I hope to see you there.